Bona nit, molt benvinguts. En primer lloc, ens toca saludar-vos per part dels qui no hi poden ser, perquè hi ha tot un seguit d'actes avui és un dia molt dens, amb un tema molt important, i que ens han pregat sobretot. Que us diem que tant el tinent d'alcalde, senyor Pissarello, com els comissionat de memòria, senyor Ricard Vinyes, ens ha dit, sobretot, no oblideu de saludar els presents en nom nostre, que prou de greu que en sap, i us asseguro que és cert, no poder assistir a un acte que ja té una tradició a Barcelona. No oblideu. I aquest any, per fer la commemoració, haureu vist el mural que hi ha baix, aquest mural participatiu en memòria de les víctimes de l'Holocaust, no està encara completat, ja us en diran alguna cosa, aquest mural que s'està completant i que després d'estar uns dies a l'espai públic, enmig del que era la plaça del Rei, la plaça del Palau Reial de Barcelona, passarà uns dies més dins de la capella de Santa Àgata, quan ja no pugui estar més en espai públic, doncs, com és la voluntat de tenir aquests primers dies. La segona cosa és agrair molt la col·laboració, doncs allò, no? Vull dir, entre programes de memòria, Eurom, que tenim aquí el doctor Guixé, que alguna cosa us en dirà com a responsable, el MUBA, que hi ha col·laborat, i les altres entitats que han pres part en l'organització de l'acte. Dit això, vaig deixar la paraula a Jordi Guixé, que ens farà l'honor de presentar el doctor Chivinski. Doctor Chivinski, és un honor tenir-lo aquí per parlar del que parlarà i és un referent pel nostre museu, la tasca que vostè fa en el seu. Tingui-ho per segur, el coneixem. Moltes gràcies.
Molt bé, moltes gràcies, Joan. Sempre és un honor compartir programació i taula doncs amb tu i amb aquesta casa, el Museu d'Història de la Ciutat de Barcelona. I, d'alguna manera, també estem molt contents des de l'Observatori Europeu de Memòries doncs, també compartir taula amb el Pietro Chivinski. D'alguna manera, doncs, fa molt poc, recentment, aquest any passat, doncs, el Museu Memorial d'Auschwitz també es va afegir com a soci d'aquesta xarxa transnacional que hem creat i que vam crear des de la Fundació Solidaritat de la Universitat de Barcelona i que és aquesta xarxa de l'Observatori Europeu de Memòries, on ens preocupen els temes, els debats sobre la memòria democràtica, sobre els conflictes memorials, però també treballem constantment en tres eixos, l'eix transnacional, l'eix multidisciplinari. Els historiadors intentem transmetre i interpretar la memòria, però no tenim la propietat de la memòria de la història, com ja sabeu, doncs des del periodisme, els mitjans de comunicació, l'antropologia, l'art, l'arquitectura, la museologia, doncs la memòria és tan interdisciplinar des d'altres, òbviament, disciplines acadèmiques, la filosofia, m'han descuidat moltes, i que nosaltres treballem permanentment transnacionalitat, interdisciplinaritat i després també, com podeu veure aquí davant, a la plaça del Rei, memòria participativa. Memòria participativa, veig algunes amigues també del col·lectiu de dones de la presó de les Corts, molt benvingudes. Doncs va ser el primer projecte que vam fer també aquí a la ciutat de Barcelona, també convidant experts internacionals sobre recuperar, per exemple, en aquell cas, la invisibilitat de la memòria de la presó de dones de les Corts, presó durant el franquisme i la Guerra Civil, que és allà on hi ha el Cort Inglés, per si qui no ho sàpigui, de múltiples invisibilitats. I aquesta memòria participativa l'hem volgut fer també per commemorar aquesta setmana els diferents actes que conjuntament amb el programa de memòria de l'Ajuntament de Barcelona estem organitzant. Un és aquest mural participatiu, amb alumnes, he d'agrair molt a l'Institut Moisès Broggi, amb alumnes de batxillerat artístic, conjuntament amb l'Emília Ricard, professora de la Universitat de Barcelona, de la Facultat de Belles Arts, i l'artista Roc Black Bloc, doncs que d'alguna manera han abocat i abocaran, demà s'acabarà, doncs aquest mur de memòria, aquest mur que recorde doncs, aquest genocidi, aquest holocaust, aquest dia internacional i que commemora aquest dia internacional de les víctimes de l'holocaust, que és el 27 de gener cada any. No? D'alguna manera, la part participativa també ens interpel·la i havia de ser per nosaltres interpel·lar la ciutadania i ens interpel·la a tots nosaltres com a ciutadans i ciutadanes en l'espai públic. I els que ja ho sabeu, doncs ens agrada molt treballar i representar, transmetre aquesta memòria amb noves generacions, amb noves disciplines, com en aquest cas és el grafiti, el mural i l'art mural, i també, òbviament, doncs, aquests espais públics, que són els espais, les àgores, on també la memòria es transmet d'una manera col·lectiva entre tots nosaltres. Sense més dilacions, l'altre i avui l'acte que estem fent en aquest moment doncs és l'acte potser més acadèmic, però també li hem volgut donar una amplitud, diguéssim, des de el que Pietro Sivinski ha titulat com Auschwitz entre la memòria i la responsabilitat. Una amplitud des de la transmissió. No només serà una conferència històrica sobre els fets, sinó ell és el capdavanter, és el director d'un dels memorials, o el memorial més visitat del món, i òbviament és un dels llocs autèntics, únics i originals de la barbària de l'Holocaust, que avui recordem i commemorem, on ja sabeu doncs, que, òbviament, doncs, aquest genocidi, aquesta barbària, aquest Holocaust, la primera víctima i la principal víctima és el poble jueu, però no només, i no només parlem de víctimes d'altres nacionalitats, com els soviètics russos no jueus, no? Parlem de jueus de 6 milions, però després també de presoners de guerra, d'uns 3 milions, aquests soviètics no jueus, 54 milions, polonesos, serbis, ahir també es va recordar, òbviament, el genocidi ètnic doncs, del Sinti al Roma, dels presoners polítics, de les persones discapacitades a través de les accions T4, per exemple, on a Berlín també, per fi, tenim un memorial a l'espai públic, que hi ha també, no?, al costat de la Filarmònica de Berlín, per recordar aquestes víctimes dels discapacitats físics, òbviament els homosexuals i molts altres col·lectius, no? Els associats, delinqüents, etcètera. Però no parlarem tant d'història, sinó de com es transmet aquesta memòria d'aquest holocaust, d'aquest genocidi, en un lloc que a mi i a nosaltres ens interessa molt també des de l'Observatori, que és l'originalitat i l'autenticitat del lloc i de l'espai. Va passar allà i no va passar enlloc més. Va passar en altres camps també, però vull dir, van passar en aquests camps, en aquests llocs d'extermini, i no a altres llocs. No? I a vegades aquesta dicotomia, quan viatgem pel món i amb altres memorials, altres museus que visitem, òbviament la història se'ns explica, i avui ho parlàvem al migdia, no? A través cada vegada de noves tecnologies, i és molt fàcil, relativament fàcil, descarregar-se una web, una aplicació mòbil i aprendre de la història, per sort, la història ha de ser com més difusa i pública possible millor, però sobretot ell ens explicarà, el professor i el doctor Sivinski ens explicarà exactament quin és el valor i quina és la seva experiència en un lloc, a part de tan visitat, diguéssim, un dels llocs icònics i més autèntics d'aquesta barbària i d'aquest genocidi. No? D'alguna manera, nosaltres com a observatori ho recordem, ho commemorem, cada any fem actuacions, igual que el Museu d'Història de la Ciutat i altres col·lectius diferents, i estem molt agraïts, sobretot, doncs, que aquesta xarxa pugui anar teixint els seus fils, i realment doncs, els nostres socis, els nostres col·legues doncs, de la resta d'Europa, que tenen unes agendes molt apretades, puguin ser aquí a Barcelona entre tots nosaltres. No? Sense més dilacions, perquè heu vingut a escoltar amb ell i no a mi, us presentaré a Pietro Sivinski, que és òbviament el director del Museu Memorial d'Auschwitz-Birkenau, és doctor en Humanitats, el seu origen és d'historiador medieval també, però ha sigut durant molt temps fundador i president de la Fundació Auschwitz-Birkenau i té una llarga trajectòria sobretot en l'ensenyament i l'educació sobre l'Holocaust. I entre els anys 2005 i 2014 també va exercir de vicepresident del Consell del Centre Internacional d'Educació sobre Auschwitz i l'Holocaust. Ha publicat molts llibres, no els citaré aquí tots, però moltes monografies, sobretot sobre aspectes diversos de diferents col·lectius que van viure des de diferents perspectives, doncs la seva experiència, diguéssim, personal dins els camps i sobretot dins a Auschwitz, no? Sobre, precisament, per exemple, un llibre sobre el transport dels polítics polonesos, dels presoners polítics polonesos, un altre sobre els presoners dels Sonderkommandos, aquests comandos nazis, un altre sobre els evacuats, els presoners evacuats d'Auschwitz, un altre sobre els sobrevivents, els escapets, que es diuen en francès, els sobrevivents del camp d'Auschwitz, i després també un monogràfic sobre els jueus. Sense més dilacions, thank you very much. You are very welcome in our city, in Barcelona.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, excuse me first, I'm completely unable to do this conference in Catalan language. Even my English is not perfect, but I hope everything will be okay. I will not focus on the history of Auschwitz. That is well known, I suppose. There are many books, many references where you can find all the documents and all the information that you should maybe need. Taking account that it was, of course, the biggest of the extermination camps and of the concentration camps of the whole system of the German Nazi camps, it started like in 1940, like a relatively small concentration camp, especially at the first 2 years dedicated to Polish political prisoners, and slow by slow enlarged, and he becomes in 40. Yes, here you can see some pictures, some paintings done by survivors about the reality of the camp. We have a quite important collection of those paintings, all done by survivors. So it's a kind of testimonies. It's very, very important visual testimonies. Those prisoners were killed at the work, by many diseases, different punishments, executions. But it was, let's say, a part of the history of the camp. From 40 until the liberation in January 45, 90% of the victims of Auschwitz, of course, were killed for a completely different reasons than any political appreciations. They were killed only for one reason, like this family of the Silesia region, quite near Auschwitz, because they were Jewish. Nobody from this family survived the camp. However, they arrived relatively late in 44. The images of the arrival of the Hungarian transport in May, June 44 are very well known. We don't really know who exactly took these pictures. There are some controversies among the historians. For sure, there were pictures taken by the SS for the purpose that we don't really know. Basically, it was forbidden to take pictures inside the camp, even for the SS. However, an album like this survived the war. That's why the transport, the Hungarian transport, are the best documented until now. And on those pictures, we see one of the biggest gas chambers and crematoria in Birkenau as a second plan. And after the war, remains an enormous space of the former camp. 40, 60, 80 kilometers square, it depends how we judge it, if we consider all the sub camps or not. And there was a long discussion, nearly 2 years discussion in Poland, among the survivors mainly, what to do with this experience, with this place, with this site. There was no really any think that we should compare at that time in the human civilizations, how to apprehend the remains, let's say. There was different proposals, some survivors proposed that it was a so alien place that we have to change it in something positive, so maybe creating a university in this place. It was some positivist, let's say, approach, how to deal with all that building, all that space. Some others say that nobody will never understand what happened here, so we can destroy everything because the next generation will certainly not understand our experience. But slow by slow, the concept of a memorial was developed, and this concept used only the relatively small Auschwitz I camp, you can see it written down on the pictures, and the enormous Birkenau up on the picture. And it's very interesting because, of course, they should also use, for example, Monowitz, the third part of the camp, or sub-camps, or place of slave labor of the prisoners. No, they choose only those two parts, because those two parts, in their mind, is enough to explain everything. It's very interesting because from the beginning we are, let's say, in a symbolic level of discussion. Today it's normal, we all know that Auschwitz is a symbol about all the atrocity of, you know, the Shoah, the different camps, of all the avian, but from the beginning they choose those two parts as symbols for an entire system of the camp. And slow by slow, let's say, the visitors were coming and was visiting this area in the 50s, in the 60s, during the communist time. In majority, there were survivors who served as guides. It was relatively, of course, moving for the people who were visiting at that time, but on the other side, it was very difficult because a survivor didn't tell the entire story of Auschwitz. He just presented what he saw. If he was in Auschwitz, he was not in Birkenau. If he was in Monowitz, he was not in Auschwitz. So it was very moving, but very, very difficult. And slow by slow, from the 70s, some, let's say, professional guide, historians or educators take the floor. Now, of course, there's no more survivors or guiding in Auschwitz. From time to time, there's still somebody who is coming with a group, in general, unable to do all the walk of 4 hours through the camp. 10 years ago, when I started, maybe not the majority, but half of the group were accompanied by survivors. Now, of course, it's finished, or nearly finished. And the number of the visitors is growing terribly. Here you see, completely down, we are in 1959, and up we are in 2017. It started to grow from 2001, 2002. And it's very interesting because at that time, many voices in the whole Europe are saying, okay, we are changing the century, we are changing everything. The survivors are slowly passing away. There are new generation. The Europe is reunificated. We have to think about the future. We have to think about other things. You will see the number will slow by slow regress and nearly, let's say, this page of the history with time. Nothing like this. Last 2 years, it was 2 million visitors every year, majority young people, coming from very, very different spaces. You can see that maybe the geography of the visitors are certainly covering the geography of the Shoah and the geography of the Second World War in Europe. It's very, very interesting. Here we don't see, but among the others, one of the most present group of visitors are coming from the Southern Korea. Between 20 and 40,000 people every year. Or people from China. They're coming with their own tragedies. You remember the Manchuria wars against Japan, they are thinking about this in terms of genocide, in terms of atrocities, and they are coming to Auschwitz to see and to understand their own history. So it's quite difficult because we are still in this symbolic, let's say, level of discussion. Of course, our guides are speaking about Auschwitz and not about Manchuria, but in the eyes of those people, we see the questions about Manchuria. It became a worldwide symbol. And there was a discussion that we started maybe more than 10 years ago. What is important now? Should we enter in political discussion with the world of today? Should we enter in some new technologies putting everywhere some screens that you can touch, you can change, all should be virtual, pretexting that young generations like it? Or should we still continue to show Auschwitz as it remains in the approach, let's say, when we explain through the authenticity of the place what happened? It was a very, very interesting discussion with many, many different voices of many really specialists all around the world, from Israel, from Europe, from United States, from Canada. And I would like to show you some elements of the answers. Here you have some historical and some nearly today's photo of Dachau near Munich. You see that there are some differences. In the main camp, that is, let's say, in blue, nearly all the barracks disappear, but there are some new construction at the end of the camp. You see also some round elements that was not in the historical camps. What it is? Churches and chapels. It's very strange, but in that moment, it started since the 60s, I think, in Dachau, but it was until the early 90s. People were thinking that maybe religion will give some answer to a such terrible place. And they built in Dachau 5 or 6 chapels or small churches, even a wooden Orthodox, like Russian, let's say, or a church. Now there's more churches in Dachau than authentic buildings. It's very strange. But it was their imagination at that time that maybe through religion we can, let's say, give some answer. Of course, it's impossible. We know that very, very well. You don't have to be a theologian to understand that there's no final answer to that. And visitors are not really visiting those churches and those chapels, but they are focusing on the authentic buildings of Dachau. Here we have another proposal, also developed 3 years. All that monuments are in the entrance of Mauthausen in Austria. And it's only a part of the monuments that were built here. Before you enter to Mauthausen, you go through a wood of monuments, built by different country, different groups, different, I don't know, ideas. Some from the communist time, some from the 90s. There is one monument for the East Germany, one monument for the West Germany. It's something very strange, but there were really a time where people were thinking that a monument is the central idea of a memorial. You cannot imagine a place of memory without a monument. Of course, nobody looked at that monument because everybody want to enter as quick as possible into the camp, to see the camp, and not monuments. It's very strange, but it was like this, that monuments should give some answer. Inside Mauthausen, it's also very, very strange, because in the wall, you have many different plaques with many different inscriptions. For groups of prisoners, for escapes, for some tragic events. And you know, you visit it, excuse me about maybe a very inappropriate comparative remark, but is it like in a gallery of art? You know very well, the first 20 meters you read every class, the next 20 meters you just look if you recognize some names or some, I don't know, cities. The next 20 meters you go very, very quickly, and the last 100 or 200 plaques you don't read them at all. And it's very, 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 very strange because those plaques are everywhere in the walls inside Mauthausen until now. At that point, that the direction of Mauthausen published an opinion that they will not accept any more of those plaques because it's no place. Very, very strange. But there was a time that people were thinking that if you don't have an inscription, that means that the memory don't function on this place. You have to inscribe something. And we know very well that it doesn't function like this. Here you have the camp of Stutthof, not Struthof in France, but Stutthof near Gdańsk, another Poland. And I would like to show this only for tourism. There is two axes. With the red circle, you have the authentic camp, but the remains, of course. It's a part of the authentic camp. And in the yellow line, you have a completely new, let's say, road from the parking to the monument. So, when you arrive, you have to take a decision if you want to commemorate in the monument or if you want to visit the authenticity through the camp. There's two different entrances, two different ways to proceed, let's say. It's coming, of course, from that time when the monuments were the most important place in Memorial. And you have a little bit the same in Majdanek, in Lublin, in Poland. Not many building prisoners barracks remains in the from the camp, but you have a sort of entire architecture of monuments, an important axis from the entrance that is part of the monument and the aureole that is going completely apart of the camp. You can go and pay homage to the victims without entering in the former camp. Here in this picture you will see that maybe a little bit better. The camp is on your right and the axis of the commemoration is outside of the experience of the camp. It's something strange, but in a time it was like this. So the question is however important, what is more, let's say, useful, or I don't like this term, if we want to show the authenticity to the visitors, to the young peoples, or if we want to oblige them to pay homage directly. Is the most important days of the big commemorations or an everyday reality of a monument? This is a little bit the situation. In Auschwitz, in Birkenau especially, it's a little bit easier because the most important place are at the end of the, let's say, the axis of the commemoration that goes from the entrance all along the rampa until the monument. However, sometimes when there are some say official event at the monument, the participants forget completely that they are looking on the monument and on their right and on their left are the bigger gas chambers in the history of the Third Reich. Nobody put any flowers or any candles in those places. Everybody put the candles on the monument. It was like this until a few years ago when we decided to put a wagon, an authentic wagon, by the rampa in Birkenau. In the beginning, it was an idea to remember the Hungarian transport from 1944. This rampa was built for them. But very quickly, the normal public adopted this wagon as a monument. The officials, ambassadors, delegations, continue until now to put their flowers or their candles at the monument. But the individuals put the small piece of rock, small poems, small letters, small flowers on the wagon. And this was very, very interesting because the wagon was authentic, coming from that time. The monument not. The monument were built in 67. And this was for us a very essential reflection about the role of the authenticity. That is certainly not through the expression of art that is monument, certainly not through, I don't know, churches, chapels, or different installations, certainly not in that case through multimedia or through virtual reality, but through the development of the authenticity. These are some quite old-fashioned exhibition in Auschwitz. Nobody remembered them after their visit. But the human hairs, the shoes, or some authentic space like the central sauna here in Birkenau, because they are empty of installations, of maps, of I don't know what, explanations, didactical materials, everybody remembers. I'm from time to time this emptiness of the authenticity disturbs people. And twice, three times a year, there are some artists who are coming to me proposing something to let's say, avoid this emptiness. It's terrible, isn't it? Birkenau is empty. There's a strange silence inside. We have to do something for the world to understand really to the full what's going on. This is one of the proposals that there's many years ago. But there are so many others. Interfaith chapel to build in the center of Birkenau. This was a proposal with the name of all the victims. When I remarked that the majority of the victims, we don't know their name, the artists just say, oh, it's a pity. Yes, of course it's a pity, but it's not a pity because of his vision, but because of the victims. Some different dispositions. Somebody proposed to put some exhibitions inside the wooden barracks in Birkenau. Imagine what it should be. You enter in a wooden barrack, authentic barrack, and you see colors, maps. If you keep completely your let's say, your experience of this space of the camp. These are ruins of construction for the purification of water in Birkenau. Birkenau was containing 90,000 to 100,000 people at one time, so the water was also purificated. And somebody proposed to adopt them as a place of reflection. And it's very funny because in this proposal, they use the entrance gate to Birkenau as an example. But if you go out from this round architecture, you can see the authentic entrance. You don't need to see it on a picture. No, really, really, we after a long reflections, we arrived to the conclusion that we don't want to develop any new installations. We don't want to propose any exciting, let's say, built media. No art, no, let's say, I don't know what. We want to focus really on the authenticity that is speaking, I think, to everybody without words, maybe, without... you know, we are guiding in 17 or in 18 languages now. Because the majority are young people, you can't speak English to young people. They don't understand very well English. So we have to develop entire groups of guides who are speaking in different languages. But they are simple that you have not to say anything. It speaks for itself. And this is the experience of Auschwitz. Understood not as educational place, but as a little bit of religious term, a rite of passage, rite de passage. You enter and you hope that you will go out with something different in your mind, a little bit changed, a little bit more mature. This is, I think, a very good sociological religious term for this experience of the visits. Of course, it's very difficult to speak about the authenticity in a conference, even here in Catalonia, and not in Auschwitz, because authenticity is something that you have to experience yourself. But those few images, I think, will show a little bit what I am speaking about. This is a rampa in Birkenau, today. And this is the same rampa 44 years ago. We are going through the same place, and it is what we explain to those visitors. This is the central point of this rampa, with the remains of the woman camp behind, and this is the same central point of this rampa with a selection place. And people who are walking through this place know that they are proceeding on the place of the selection. This is the entrance of the women camp. The historical picture will change because there will be many wagons. However, this entrance this very entrance to the women camps. And this is the road who is going from the rampart to the crematorium number 4 and number 5. And it's so by this road we're going people for the last 20, 30 minutes of their life. It is really this place. And the same road to those two gas chambers and crematoria is the place where these very, very famous pictures were taken from the time of the Hungarian Jewish transports in the beginning of May 44. This is an experience that you can do, and no monuments, no multimedia will change it when you are on site. Of course, it's very difficult because we have 155 buildings, 200 hectares. How to deal? All those camps were not built for a long term. It was not built by specialists of constructions. It was built by prisoners. They don't wanted to build a very strong barracks. They don't wanted to be shooted during this war. This was the only one, let's say, perspective. So it's very difficult, and 6 or 7 years ago we created the Auschwitz-Birkenau Foundation, asking to many governments to help us to establish an endowment fund of 120 million euro that will never be spent. It will be invested in a very securized way, and with the incomes of this fund we will have enough money to conduct some works that will be done forever. Because to preserve everything we need 25, maybe 30 years, and after 30 years we have to come back at those items of building that we have preserved at the beginning. It's the only one, and I think the only one example in the world, nearly 40 governments put them down in common, let's say, to build this endowment. We're still looking for the last 10 million, but it's not so important because the works started since a few years in a very, very serious level. When I was arrived 11 years ago, we get 5 professionals on the preservation. Now I engaged a 32nd, I think, 2 months ago. So it's really a team of diploma conservators, but very, very important. It's the only one memorial in Europe who has some laboratories of preservation until now. Of course, we are spending this money not only on the preservation of the architectural remains, but also for the objects. Here are some new collections department. I don't like this stuff, collections, who collected what. But it's a normal, basic, let's say, language in museology, so we have no other solutions. There are many, many different things, sometimes very moving, sometimes technically very difficult to be preserved, because in the world, in general, we do not preserve things from the middle of the 20th century. If you want to preserve a medieval book, just, I don't know, some papers, let's say, inside, you just check which type of paper it is, you open a professional book of preservation. It is this type of paper, so I have to use this chemistry, I have to use these products in order to preserve it. But who preserved toothbrushes from the 20th century? Or sweet cases? Very difficult materials because they are wood, they are very different materials, metal. But of course the most difficult are the brick barracks of the former women camps in Birkenau. The problem is that we have a groundwater in 40-50 centimeters, and there are no foundations. So those buildings are moving, and the wooden buildings can adapt a little bit, even after 70 years. The brick buildings certainly have to. So this was the main, let's say, reason that pushed us to build this foundation. And we started 2 years ago with the two first brick barracks 43 are still waiting for their time. This year, in 2018, three, maybe four, but I think three will start the preservation. So in the next 10 or 15 years, you will not be able to see Birkenau without those tents that allow us to work all around the year, of course, and not only in summer. The questions are very well developed with some university, because if you have a wall that is not very ripe, in general, you dismantle it and you rebuild it again. Even with natural authentic elements, we are trying to reestablish without, let's say, destroying the authenticity of this wall. So it's a very difficult issue, something that was never done, I think, in the past. But all that, of course, for those visitors who are coming and who has the right, I think, to appear, let's say, the history of this site. And of course, the situation is becoming more and more difficult. 10 years ago, 20 years ago, when the Shoah were entering in the programs in the schools, many people were thinking that yes, it is a good progress, and now many issues are saved, are secularized. People will be more responsible. It's an important step. Yes, of course, it was an important step. It's certainly better than the Shoah is learned in schools. But we see in our Europe today that we didn't want. Certainly, we didn't want. We are still accusing, terribly accusing those people from 70 years ago or 75 years ago to be bystanders, to do nothing in time of wars, in time of a terror, SS and Gestapo terror. But today, without war and without terror, with internet, with knowledge 24 hours on 24, we are still bystanders in many situations. Just now, there are ethnic purification, let's say, I use this Nazi term, in Burma. Now, not 1 year ago, now. Who cares? There was 2-3 articles, let's say, maybe 2 months ago or 3 months ago in some newspapers. Yes, one meeting on the United Nations who condemned those events. Nothing. And especially in Europe, we see an increasing of populism, of demagogy, of xenophobia, of far right positions. And we still don't know, I think, how to deal with that. Certainly our schools programs are not prepared to that. We are still teaching like we were teaching 50 years ago. Excuse me. All our countries. It's some small changes, of course. But where are the lessons about who, let's say, would prepare our children to be ready to affront, for example, the demagogia, or the xenophobia, or the populistic, propositions in the public or political, let's say, language? Who will prepare our children to be ready to be confronted to, let's say, different type of propaganda in the media, and in the media that changed so quickly as now? As now. 10 years ago, it was a completely different media. If you take a newspaper from 20 years ago, I don't know, Corriere della Sera, Le Monde, Frankfurt Allgemeine, it was a completely different newspaper than now, with analysis, with projections, with discussion, with dialogue inside. Now, in the time of Facebook, everything's falling in a simple way. How to present very briefly an idea, and after four or five hours this idea is overpassed by other ideas, and we are not preparing our next generations to that. Remember in the schools, excuse me if among us are brilliant mathematicians, do not take it personally, but before your baccalaureate, you learned during hundreds of hours the functions in mathematics, f, x, who used it one time after finished the baccalaureate? And during that time you didn't learn enough how to prepare yourself to be confronted to the populism, to the propaganda, to some voice of hatred, to how to be criticized to the politicians, for example. Criticize in the noble term. How to think critically, let's say, of what you see. It's very, very difficult, and of course, if it's difficult in our society, it's certainly more difficult in a place like Auschwitz. Sometimes it's hard to sleep, let's say, quietly in the night when we think about this. Of course, we are working with our guides, 300 guides. We do not allow them to enter very directly to the today politics problems of different countries, because it's not their role to show a concrete solution to the visitors. They cannot use the drama of the victims. The drama of the victims do not belong to our guides. But they must, let's say, in a way, show to those visitors that they have to think about their own responsibility in their own life. It means something different, for example, in Barcelona, something different in, South Korea, something different in Russia, in the United States, in, difficult cities or whatever. Yeah. We are preparing, of course, some special programs for special groups that are more confronted in their life to those issues of human rights or crucial questions of today's reality. The one and the other, certainly. And it's certainly not easy. We are trying to have some new discussion on a very, very high level. Here it's a meeting of ambassadors in the United Nations in New York 2 years ago, I think. I've got a long presentation about Auschwitz, and I must tell you that the discussion that was after turned me in the most pessimist way that I should remember it. It was a clearly political discussion, yes. The decision number 25C20, yes, is fully respected by my country. Who? Nothing to do with the reality. It's really stressful at the level that I was knowing that it would be difficult, but I was not knowing that it would be so difficult. It was another world, something incredible. Now I'm not surprised that they are unable to have a real position, active position, about what's happening in Burma. Now I understand it. In 10 years I will be able to condemn it. It will be too late, of course. But we try, however, to enter in some different others, public spheres. The book fairs in Torino, in Italia. People who go to book fairs don't think that they will be discussing Auschwitz issue, but 700 people were coming to a meeting about Auschwitz. Of course, the main commemorations, especially when it's around the anniversary, is a special moment to speak to really worldwidely. The commemoration of the 70th anniversary of the liberation 3 years ago was attract a public live on the TV of 500 million people around the world through 200 channels. I don't think that there was any commemorations of that dimension in our history. 500 million people, that it's certainly more than the number of people who really understood that it is a Shoah. And I speak only about those who were on before before the TV, not those who read some articles or, I don't know, newspapers. And now we try to go in some new directions. We are starting to adapt this building. It is close to Auschwitz I, to a completely new educational center, because the problem that a simple visit is not enough. And more of people would like to have some educational proposals after the visit, a place of discussions, confronting some ideas, and we need to have some place for this. It's not easy, especially the winter in Poland is not exactly like here now, so it's impossible to do that in wooden barracks, for example, and I'm sure that it will be a very, very important tool for the future. We are developing a completely new main exhibition, the general exhibition. This that you can see now in Auschwitz is from 1955. It's played a very important role and will save certainly the most important part of this exhibition. That means an exhibition that is not a historical, let's say, narrative, but an exhibition that is a phenomenological approach, more showing than speaking about. But we need to prepare a completely new exhibition, also for technical issues. For example, the suitcase will be put in a sort of presentation without oxygen inside, because if not, it's impossible to save those suitcases or the shoes for a longer time. We are organizing many conferences with specialists from all around Europe, Israel, North America, because those problems, how to speak in the today's reality, is exactly the same problem that has been in Yatashe, in Memorial of the Holocaust in Washington, here and all the world, really changed so quickly in the last 10 years. Think about one thing. I think the first time in our, let's say, imagination of the international relations, that there are so many places in the world when we are not sure if it's already a war or still a difficult peace. That's happened between Russia and Ukraine now. Is it a situation of war or not? And there are so many places like this in Africa or many other places. 50 years ago, it would be impossible to not have the definition. It's a war or not a war. It's simple, zero or one. Now, 4 months ago, we launched a first multi-magazine about the memory in English and in Polish. Not to show what we are doing in Auschwitz, but to show what, in general, is done all around the world. Because I think that for a long, too long time, all our institutions, Memorial de la Shoah or the others, were working a little bit alone, a little bit for themselves, building their own institution. We must now really establish a completely new level of cooperation. If not, we'll lose 20 years. I'm sure about it. Now we still have some survivors. Now the topic is still very present. But if we don't stop now to work on what will be in 20 years, we will lose it. For example, the exhibition that we opened with some collaborators from Madrid, in Madrid, is also a completely new experience for us. Preparing a so huge exhibition, 2,500 square meters, that has to, in the next 7 or maybe 10 years, because there are so many different places that like to have it all around the world. It's a completely new experience for us. Of course, we were traveling with some small exhibitions, let's say, nothing so important, but there are too many people that are unable to make the trip to Auschwitz, maybe only for financial reasons or psychological reasons, and people who don't want. So it's our role to go to their cities, to their countries. We will observe this, let's say, first experience at this level, but the first remarks that I received, the first reports from Madrid are extremely positive. This is another exhibition about Art of Auschwitz in the West Point Academy in the United States. But still there is one topic, and I will finish by this, that we have some difficulties all around Europe to let's say, really analyze it and to speak it and to show it, to educate about it. Here you have the victims. The day of the liberations, the work of the prisoners of the camp, those two young boys from the Hungarian transport, the younger, 9 years old, his eyes are on the new, relatively new 10 years, logo of the Auschwitz Memorial, and this family that I show at the beginning. But there are some other pictures from Auschwitz that we still don't know how to speak about it. Of course it's very difficult. Of course there are a terrible lack of documents because they burn everything that they were able to burn before the retreat. Of course they do not let any testimonies. And of course the families do not give us, let's say, their letters or the private documentations. But from the anthropological point of view, the problem is not with the victims. The victims were innocent and they were killed. Relatively, excuse me, simple as anthropological problem. The real anthropological problem is here. And during the last 50 or 60 years, nearly no one memorial in Europe, their faces were present. It was focused only on victims. That is very noble. I don't want to diminish this question of victims, of course. But if we do not speak about the perpetrators, I don't know really how. This is a reflection that we must have, every one of us. We don't create an axis, an ethical axis, a moral axis of human compromise. We just show one part, one tragical part. We ask people to emphasize, let's say, to feel like I'm frank. It's very noble, but it's a little bit easy. If the risk exists, that means that the risk is in every one of us. In every one of us. And this is some images that appears, I don't know, 12 years ago, I think, in the United States. A team of SS and women from Auschwitz, 40 kilometers southern to the Auschwitz camps during a weekend. Yes, they have some free times. One day, let's say, they were going with a car, and they would go back after to Auschwitz and to Birkenau to continue their work. And those pictures were also taken in 1944, like the pictures of the Hungarian transport.
Espero que ho heu trobat interessant. Moltes coses s'han dit sobre la taula. Doncs, si voleu preguntar alguna qüestió.
Le quiero agradecer muchísimo lo que usted ha logrado meter en una hora y cuarto, destripar y desvestir la tragedia que vivió la humanidad en la primera mitad del siglo XIX. Yo quería hacer el siguiente comentario. En 1923, Adolf Hitler estaba preso y en la cárcel escribió Mein Kampf. Y en Mein Kampf, mi lucha, Adolf Hitler dijo todo lo que iba a hacer, sin mentir y sin vaselina. En 1919, el Tratado de Versalles estableció que Alemania no podía crecer ni tener más de 100.000 hombres militares y no podía crecer industrialmente ni iniciar ningún tipo de situación bélica. estoy hablando de 1919. En 1933, Adolf Hitler llegó a ser canciller de Alemania y Chamberlain y Daladier trataron, los cancilleres de Francia y de Inglaterra, trataron de apaciguar el proyecto de Adolf Hitler. La pregunta que yo quiero hacer en este momento, cuando es la segunda parte de la pregunta de vuestra conferencia, es las responsabilidades. No ya las responsabilidades de ahora, que todos tenemos estructuras éticas y morales suficientes como para de alguna manera abarcar el tema, pero en 1942, 1943, la agencia judía le mandó una carta, cuya carta está en el Museo del Holocausto de Washington, en el Mall, donde decía al señor Dwight Eisenhower, comandante en jefe de las Fuerzas Armadas, que por favor arrojaran unas bombas sobre las vías férreas de trocha angosta que unían Krakow con Auschwitz-Birkenau. La respuesta está en el Mall de Washington y la respuesta está también en Yad Vashem, en Israel. Eisenhower comentó, le contó, le respondió a la agencia judía que la cabeza de la serpiente estaba en Berlín y que era imposible derivar absolutamente ningún esfuerzo para acabar con la cabeza de la serpiente. Se salvaban alrededor de 6.000 personas por día. Los trenes iban llenos y volvían vacíos. Lo sabían en Osijek, en Auschwitz, lo sabían en toda Europa, y toda Europa sabía qué era lo que estaba pasando en con el Holocausto, y nadie movió un dedo para impedirlo, salvo algunos brillantes momentos de países del norte de Europa. Mi pregunta, y perdón el comentario, mi pregunta, ¿cómo fue posible que Europa en aquel momento utilizase la mano de obra infame del asesinato alemán y todo lo demás no procedió a lo mismo, ya sea por acción o por omisión? ¿Por qué fue posible el holocausto, no ya solo de judíos, de sacerdotes católicos, de comunistas, de homosexuales, de gitanos? ¿Qué fue lo que pasó en Europa y qué puede pasar en el futuro si esto no se aclara?
Yes, of course, there was many sources before the war of what should or what could appear, first of all, in Germany, after in all the occupied Europe. But I think there was a lack of trust or a lack of imagination. When in 1942, when officers of the Polish underground states arrived in London with the first information about what's passing in the death camps, I'm not speaking about concentration camps, but the death camps, some very well-documented first information that he transmitted to the government of Great Britain, the United States, and the rest of the free world, even the Grand Rabbi of Great Britain, that he, I understand what you told to me, but it's impossible. I think it was a lack of imagination at that time, and if I compared the situation of the bystanders at the time of the war with us, as bystanders, we are certainly in the worst situation from the ethical point of view, because we know. It's not a question of imagination, trust, or something like this. We know that it was, and we know it was after the war in different countries, and we know it now, and we still do nothing. The problem is deeper. The problem is not at a political level, I think. The problem starts really, really in deep. Of course, it's very easy to to create a situation where you are very near of a genocide. You need just a part of the population that is frustrated for different reason. You add words of populism that explain to the frustrated people that they are not completely down in the society. No, they are the best. But to prove it, you just have to show them a common, let's say, enemy. Because that explains that they feel that they are completely down, in fact, they are the best. It was like this in all the genocide of the 20th century. All. Not only in Europe. Frustration, populism, and common enemy. And the responsibility now, if I have to define the place where I should search it, it's certainly in an intelligent remembrance, that means not a remembrance turned only to the past, but a remembrance that is fruit of the imagination of the future. A remembrance that is a tool of control of what's passing today. But for that, if you want not only to work with the civil society, with some associations, some groups of people of goodwill, we must work on our educational system, which is really coming from the 19th century. Many, many things changed after the war. Many things. The European Union, for example, as a way to try to be together. The legal changes, the definition of the genocide, the definition of the crime against humanity, the creation of a real civil society. You know, the association before the war, it was a paramilitary and many times kind of group when they walked through the city with, I don't know, uniforms and all that things. The old, let's say, groups of students, for example, in the university in the 20s, it was something completely different as today. The philosophy changed. Even in the church, the religions, is a ecumenical programs developed after the war. It's for the same reason. We have to try to live together. So there are many changes, but if we want that those changes will not affect only certain people, we have to rethink the educational system in all our country. And it will be very difficult because I do not really imagine easily politicians wanted to create, for example, 1 hour every week of a critical political, let's say, discussion in the schools for the 14, 15 or 16 years old teenagers. And it is the best time to thinking critical, because at that time really people are critical when they are 16 years old. I like this period. I remember it was maybe the most interesting period of my own way of the world. But of course, it depends, in fact, what was for us Auschwitz and what was the Shoah. If it was only one point on the never ending, we hope everybody likes it, like so, let's say, axis of the history, from the prehistoria until the never ending world, there's maybe no reason to take in Auschwitz or the Shoah at the point of reference. But if it was a real point of non-return, a real point of reference that the civilization has to change after, I think now, in the beginning of the 21st century, we are for the first time really confronted to this choice. Because some, let's say, aspects of our civilization were certainly easier in the 50s, in the 60s, when many people remembered the war and when the systems were, even the word of system, when you have no system, you feel like oppressed. But the system is a system, it's not bad or good, it depends on what kind of system it is. No, we are really in a turning point now, so we need to reform more, I'm sure about it, to the most important experience when we can find some universal answers. And in our European experience, Auschwitz is among them, certainly. If not, the responsibility will be, yes, there will be people more responsible, less responsible, and completely irresponsible. And with populism, those will win.
Jo tinc un dubte molt des del punt de vista de la gestió cultural sobre l'experiència de les visites guiades per una banda de grups sols i les noves generacions, si hi ha una frivolització, s'ha comentat o s'ha criticat una mica la frivolització de l'espai d'Auschwitz en algunes visites lliures, això per una part, i després com abordar 2 milions de persones de visitar. Si realment hi haurà una política, diguéssim, d'acceptació o de benvinguda o algunes restriccions en referència a això.
You ask yourself for a short question and now you hope I will shortly answer this. No, first of all, it's very difficult to refuse the entrance to somebody. If there are so many people who are coming, I have to deal with. I cannot make selections at the entrance most of the time. No. But of course, a site is a meetup. So we introduced some limitations 2 or 3 years ago to 1,000 people per hour. You have to reserve your time through internet, like when you go to the cinema. If the entire cinema is full, you must wait till another time. Of course, it's difficult, but it was the only possible choice, of course. But it's easy to say that the guide visits not maybe the best choice, but it will be the best choice. If we accept people in nearly 20 languages, what should be the inscriptions until everyone objects? Imagine a classical museography, you have, I don't know, a spoon, 20 languages. The history of a spoon. It's completely impossible. And also, you know, the meaning of some reality of Auschwitz, or the understanding of some questions change. Because some questions were entering the school programs, so we don't need to repeat them so, let's say, critically, like maybe 20 years ago. It's more, let's say, life to work with a guide than to change everything's every exhibition every 5 or 10 years. Some people, from time to time, some theorem, some society proposes the development of some audio guides because it's allow individual visits. I, as long as I will be director of Auschwitz-Birkenau, there will not be one single audio guide in Auschwitz. For just one reason. In the educational process, it's very important to give some information to the young people who is coming. It's maybe 50% of the success. The feedback from the emotional point of view and the intellectual also, the other 50% of the success is to receive the answer that we give to you. Sometimes you do, to receive the question, let's say, that it asks you. Maybe you cannot have answer to those questions. If a visitor, yes, but God, at that time, where was God? You can't answer these questions. The most eminent theologians didn't propose an answer that would be accepted by everybody. But the way that you receive these questions is terribly important, especially for young people who have some difficulty to express themselves, of course. If you look through the visit, in Auschwitz one, let's say it's more a transmission of knowledge from the guides to the visitors. But in Birkenau, the space becomes bigger, the silence becomes longer, the visitors come to the guide and ask themselves some important issues. And it's, you can't ask your questions to an electronic environment. It's not the same. You can't look in the eyes of an audio guide. That's why we train every single, let's say, month our guides, and we hope that they will be better and better. We develop some new language because, for example, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, there was not many visitors from Czech Republic, maybe 4,000 or 5,000. It's very close. But after the show entered the program for school, it jumped to 40,000 or 50,000. So we needed some new guides. We can adapt, let's say, to this situation. But of course, it's very difficult. It takes us enormous of time, of money also. The guide, the French-speaking guides, because they don't go every 5 years in France to look at the difference of the book of history, to discuss with some new people in the Memorial de la Shoah or in Izieux. Or they lose the contact with the, let's say, the evolution of the remembrance of France. So, of course, it's very, very difficult, but I prefer working with normal life people than with any kind of installations or machines. But seriously, more than 1,000 people per hour, it's impossible. That means that even if more and more people will come very early in the morning, it's difficult to arrive at 7:30 from Krakow, or they will stay very late in the day, we will, I think, never go over 3,200,000. This is the maximum, mathematically maximum. For the security of the people and for the security of the site also. We must balance those two issues. That's why we are more and more present in the internet, through the exhibitions that are walking around the world, also publications through books that we publish in many, many different languages. Have to go out with this of our fences.
Es una pregunta que desde que me gusta conocer la historia siempre me la he tenido ahí. Y era, vale que no sabíamos qué hacían ellos, ¿vale? Pero qué hacían las potencias, ¿sabes? Americanas, inglesas, todas las que están en contra del nazismo, ¿qué hacían? ¿Me entiendes? Porque Estados Unidos no atacó, no empezó a la guerra, no entró en guerra hasta que no atacaron Pearl Harbor. Es decir, si no hubieran atacado Pearl Harbor, hubieran seguido los nazis matando y expandiéndose. ¿Me entiendes? Porque tú veías que se iban expandiendo y nadie se movía, ¿me entiendes? Se quería seguir ahí y la gente de Inglaterra, Churchill estaba deseando que entrara a Estados Unidos en la guerra. Y no se movía. Y Churchill ya no sabía que defendía las cartas y por favor, entrar. Y no hacían nada. Mi opinión era hasta que. ¿Qué pasó? ¿Qué opinan ustedes?
These are general questions, but in fact, I don't know what will be if not Pearl Harbor. I think there will be some other reason for the United States to enter the world. Economical reasons, perhaps. But in fact, why they are not, for example, destroy these railways? Because they were thinking it will not change anything. You can repair railways in 1 or 2 days after a bomb attack. So if they send some bombarders on Auschwitz, and it happened 4 times that a big group of bombarders were sent on Auschwitz, they go over the camp and they destroy the factories, the military factories that was near to the camp, because their goal was to finish the war as quick as possible. This was one of the explanations. The other one was a very strange one, but all this history is strange, that according to the legal, let's say, definitions in the United States, at that time you cannot use military tools to a civilian, let's say, installations. And the camp was considered as a civilian camp and not a military camp. There was also some positions like this. But I think it's a lack of imaginations.
Potser per acabar, i vist que som molt en història, m'agradaria afegir
que aquí ens trobem amb dos tipus de coneixement i que requereixen dos tipus de tractament. Aquí se'ns ha parlat de la importància de l'autenticitat, de la importància de tenir molt present el que pot passar quan fins i tot es qüestiona la humanitat. I això, en els museus i en els espais de memòria, s'ha de tractar d'una manera. Hi ha una altra cosa que és explicar una mica com va la història, el perquè de tot passar. Són dos nivells diferents. Si no expliquem, correm perill. Si no sentim, per què explicar? Són dues maneres de tractar la realitat que, des del punt de vista dels museus, ens costen molt i que en el punt de confluència entre la memòria i la història hem de saber trobar el tractament de cadascú. I per això jo deia al començament, moltes gràcies per les seves lliçons en aquest museu, que és d'història, però que tenim fets molt vius com la Guerra Civil Espanyola tan present i com la pròpia presència de la ciutat de Barcelona a l'Holocaust, que molts van morir. Doncs és bé que sóc saber trobar algú entre les diferents aproximacions. Moltes gràcies, doncs. Moltes gràcies, Europa.